Shabbat Shalom. I will read to you from Yeshua'yahu, chapter 42, verses 1 through 4. Here is my servant, whom I support, my chosen one, in whom I take pleasure. I have put my spirit, Ruach HaKodesh, upon him. He will bring justice to the Gentiles. He will not cry or shout out. No one will hear his voice in the streets. He will not snap off a broken reed. Crown of thorns that was placed around Yeshua HaMashiach's head at the crucifixion. Suffering Messiah. He did it all for us. Hallelujah. He will not snuff out a smoldering wick. 39 lashes on his back. Hallelujah. He had the fullness of the spirit of the Ruach HaKodesh. He could have called a legion of angels to stop his suffering and his crucifixion. But he did it for you and I. He will bring forth justice according to truth. He will not weaken or be crushed. In other words, he would not die. He will not be crucified until he has established justice on earth. And the coastlands wait for his Torah, the new covenant. Now I'm going to turn to Hebrews chapter, starting from chapter 8. I will start from verse 6. But now the word of Yeshua has been given to do is far superior to theirs, talking about the high priest in the Tanakh. Just as the covenant he mediates is better. Hallelujah, the new covenant. The new covenant that was prophesied in Yeshua'yahu chapter 42 verse 4. Remember they talked about the coastlines will wait for his Torah, Yeshua HaMashiach's Torah, given to us through the Spirit of the living God. For this covenant has been given as a Torah on the basis of a better promise. Indeed, if the first covenant had not given grounds for fault finding, there would have not been no need for a second one. For God does find fault with the people when he says, see, the days are coming, says Adonai, when I will establish over the house of Israel and over the house of Judah a new covenant. This is written in Jeremiah. It will not be like the covenant which I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by their hand and led them forth out of the land of Egypt. Because they, for their part, did not remain faithful to my covenant. So I, for my part, stopped concerning myself with them, says Adonai. For this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says Adonai. I will put my Torah in their minds. Hallelujah. And write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. Now, none of them will teach his fellow citizens or his brother, saying, know Adonai, for all will know me. Hallelujah. From the least of them to the greatest, because I will be merciful towards their wickedness and remember their sins no more. By using the term new, he has made the first covenant old and something better, and something being made old, something in the process of aging, is on its way to vanishing altogether. Hallelujah. Not that Yeshua HaMashiach abolished the law. He fulfilled the law. The Torah that Yahweh gave Moshe on Mount Sinai was for us to be obedient to him and to walk in righteousness and holiness. But we let him down. Humanity let him down. The Israelites were disobedient. So he had to create a new Torah. And he did this through Yeshua HaMashiach. He will write the laws on our hearts. Hallelujah. Going to chapter 9. Now the first covenant had both regulations for worship and a holy place here on earth. A tent or a tabernacle was set up, the outer one, which was called the holy place. In it were the menorah, the tablets of the bread, and the presence. Behind the second parapet was a tent called the holiest place, which had the golden altar for burning incense and the ark of the covenant, entirely covered with gold. In the ark were the gold jar containing the manna, Aaron's rod and that sprouted, and the stone tablets of the covenant, talking about the Ten Commandments. And above it were the cherubims, angelic beings, representing the presence of Yahweh, our Creator, casting their shadow on the lid of the ark. But now is not the time to discuss these things in detail. With things so arranged, the Kohanim, which means priests, go into the outer tent all the time to discharge their duties. But only the high priest enters the inner one, and he goes in only once a year. And he must always bring blood, which he offers both for himself and for the sins committed in ignorance by the people. Remember in Leviticus chapter 17, it says life is in the blood, and blood is an atonement for sin. Hallelujah. Yah puts that scripture in my spirit, and it burns in me like fire, because it is a prophecy. It was a message about the sacrificial death of Yeshua HaMashiach. By this arrangement, the Ruach HaKadosh show that so long as the first tent had standing, the way into the holiest place was still closed. This symbolized the present age and indicates that the conscience of the person performing the service cannot be brought to the goal by the gifts and sacrifices he offers. First, they involve only food and drink and various ceremonial washings. I'm going to skip down a little bit. I'm going to go to verse 11. But when Yeshua HaMashiach appeared as high priest, of the good things that are happening already, then through the greater and more perfect tent, which is not man-made, that is, it is not of this created world, he entered the holiest place once and for all. And he entered not by means of blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own holy, precious, and sanctified blood, thus setting people free forever. We're free, hallelujah, if you accept Yeshua HaMashiach as your Messiah, your Savior. For if the sprinkling ceremonially unclean person with the clean blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of heifers restores their outward purity, then how much more the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, who through the eternal spirit, the Ruach HaKadosh, offered himself to God as a sacrifice without blemish who through the eternal spirit offered himself to God as a sacrifice without blemish, will purify our conscience from works that lead to death. How does Yeshua HaMashiach purify our conscience from works that leads to death? What are these works? Galatians talks about these works. They are works of the flesh: lust, hate, sexual immorality, jealousy. These are all works of the flesh. Hallelujah. How does Yeshua HaMashiach cleanse us from these impurities or these works of the flesh? Hallelujah. I'm going to skip a little ahead. Yeshua. Hallelujah. Yeshua's identity is tied up in his death, and I will read about that a little in a minute. Yeshua. I'll go to John the Baptist. John the Baptist said, "There is one who is greater that comes after I truly baptize with water, but the one coming after I'm not worthy to loosen the sandals off his feet, for he shall baptize you with the Ruach HaKadosh and fire." So when Yeshua ascended into heaven, after he rose from the dead on the third day, he sent down the Ruach HaKadosh. You can read about it in Acts chapter 1 and chapter 2. To all those that believed. And when you believe in Yeshua HaMashiach, he will fill you with the Ruach HaKadosh. In other words, the Spirit of the living God will live within you. And the Spirit of the living God will teach you how to live holy. Hallelujah. He will guide you. Hallelujah. He will convict you. Hallelujah. He will show you how to bear fruits, because we can't do anything in our own humanity, for there's nothing good in this flesh but sin. But when the Ruach HaKadosh comes upon you, you will have great power, because the Spirit of the living God, the Spirit that rose Yeshua from the dead, lives within you. I will go on. So I explained how Yeshua will purify our conscience from work that leads to death. Hallelujah. Because sin leads to death. Spiritual death. Eternal separation from our Father. So that we can serve the living God. It is because of this death that he is mediator of a new covenant or will. Now this part is very important. Because a death has occurred which sets people free from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. Those who have been called may receive the promised eternal inheritance or eternal life. For where there is a will, there must necessarily be produced evidence of its maker's death, since a will goes into effect only upon death. It never has force while its maker is still alive. So now let's talk about the will of the Father giving in the promise of Yeshua HaMashiach. This will is interchangeably called the new covenant. It compares will with human beings' will. My husband and I just made our will. I have a will. My husband has a will. However, our will not be a until our death. Our descendants, our beneficiaries, will not benefit from our will until our death. Hallelujah. So the new covenant, hallelujah, that was ordained by Yahweh before the foundations of the earth would not take effect until the death of Yeshua HaMashiach, the will, the new covenant. I will read this part again. For where there is a will, and again, the scriptures use will interchangeably with new covenant, there must necessarily be produced evidence of its maker's death. Hallelujah. Yeshua is the word of God. Yeshua is the word of God made flesh. Hallelujah. Yeshua is equal with the Father. For he is the Father in the form of the likeness of sinful flesh. Men cannot be saved by the blood of bulls and goats, but only by the precious blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, of Yah in the flesh. Hallelujah. So Yeshua. Hallelujah. This new covenant could only be made evident after the death of Yeshua HaMashiach, since a will goes into effect only upon death. Again, remember, my will only go take effect to my beneficiaries until my death. So, the will of Yeshua, given to him through the power of Yahweh, he's the word of God, only took effect until after his death. It never has force while its maker is still alive. So, the new covenant didn't have any force or power until the death, the crucifixion of Yeshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. The new covenant, the blood covenant. Remember, life is in the blood. And blood is an atonement for sin. It's atonement for sin. All the Leviticus, they talk about sacrificing bulls and goats without spot or blemish for the remission of sins. This was a message from the Holy One of Israel of how he would save humanity. He knew that one day he would come off his holy and majestic throne in the likeness of sinful flesh. His word planted inside of a woman, a virgin, who was highly favored, because a spirit can't shed his blood. But he had a plan. He will take his word, his very mind, his very conscience, and implant it into a woman, Miriam, so that he could shed his holy blood, and it will fall down from his holy body and return back to the earth from whence men were formed. Hallelujah. This is why the first covenant too was inaugurated with blood. After Moshe had proclaimed every command of the Torah to all the people, he took the blood of the calves with some water and used scarlet wool and hyssop to sprinkle both the scroll itself and all the people. And he said, "This is the blood of the covenant which God has ordained for you." Likewise, he sprinkled with the blood both the tent and all the things used in the ceremonies. In fact, according to the Torah, almost everything is purified with blood. Indeed, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness for sins. Again, Leviticus 17:11. Life is in the blood. And blood is an atonement for sins. Now, this is how the copies of the heavenly things had to be purified. But the heavenly things themselves required better sacrifices than these. For Yeshua has entered the holiest place, which is not made man-made and merely a copy of the true one. I'm sorry. For Yeshua has entered the holiest place, which is not man-made and merely a copy of the true one, but into himself, into heaven itself, in order to appear now on our behalf, in the very presence of Yahweh. Further, he did not enter heaven to offer himself over and over again, like the high priest did in the snuff, who entered the holiest place year after year with blood that is not his own blood. For then he would have had to suffer death many times. Yeshua was only crucified once. He only needed to die one time. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now he holds the keys to death and Hades. Hallelujah. From the founding of the universe on, let me go back. Further, he did not enter heaven to offer himself over and over again, like the high priest who entered the holiest place year after year with blood that is not his own. For them, he would have had to suffer death many times from the founding of the universe on. But as it is, He has appeared once at the end of the age in order to do away with sin through the sacrifice of himself. Just as human beings have to die once, but after this comes judgment. So also, Yeshua HaMashiach, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, as it is written in Yeshua chapter 53, will appear a second time, the second coming of Yeshua HaMashiach, not to deal with sin, but to deliver those who are eagerly waiting for him. Just a little of chapter 10. For the Torah has in it a shadow of the good things to come, not the actual. Did you hear what I just said? Profound, because it's what I've been talking about in many of my videos and in this one as well, all along. For the Torah has in it a shadow. A shadow of things to come. Hallelujah. Let's read that one more time. For the Torah has in it a shadow of the good things to come. In other words, it was a mystery, a prophecy, a clandestine message that only the Holy One of Israel knew. But when Yeshua was born, and then he died and rose from the dead, that mystery was revealed. Why? Yahweh told the priest of the line of Levi to offer a bull or goat as a sin offering. It was a shadow. It was a message of good things to come. The sacrificial death of Yeshua HaMashiach.
But not the actual manifestation of the originals. Therefore, it can never, by means of the same sacrifices, repeated endlessly year after year, bring the goal those who approach the holy place to offer them. Otherwise, it without the offering of those sacrifices have ceased, for the people performing the services had been cleansed once and for all. They would no longer have sins of their conscience. No, it is quite the contrary. In these sacrifices is a reminder of sins year after year. For it is impossible that blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. This is why on coming into the world, Yeshua says, it has not been your will to have an animal sacrifice and a meal offering. Rather, you have prepared for me a body. Hallelujah. No, you have not pleased with burnt offerings and sin offerings. Then I said, look in the scroll of the book. It is written about me. I have come to do your will. Hallelujah. Let's go back. It has not been your will, Abba Father, to have animal sacrifices and meal offerings. So Abba Father didn't want animal sacrifices and meal offerings. Rather, Abba Father have prepared for Yeshua a body. No, you have not been pleased. Abba Father, Hashem, was not pleased with burnt offerings and sin offerings. Then I said, look, in the scroll, this is what Yeshua said, of the book, it is written about me. I have come to do the will of my Father. If you read John chapter 5, Yeshua talks and he says, many come in their own name and you believe him. I think of many people, false Christ, false messiahs, who have had many followers. Yeshua said, I come in not my own name, but my Father's name, and you receive me not. He said, I will not be the one to accuse you before my Father. You know who will accuse you? Moshe, the one you have counted on, the one you have believed. Because if you believed his words, you would have believed me. Because it was me that Moshe wrote about. Hallelujah. Moshe, all the way to Malachi, prophesied
about how Yah would reunite man to himself by the shedding of the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach. He came first as the suffering Savior. But when he come again, he will come in great glory and power to judge the living and the dead. And his kingdom will have no end. Shabbat Shalom.